Hello, my little acorn crop. You may have been wondering, where the hell have I been? And, well, I'm gonna tell you, I've had a few issues, which you may or may not care about. But, unfortunately, I have a sick kitty cat who's gonna have to take the long walk. So I've been a little stressed about that. And, as you know, I had a sick horse, which is gonna be the primary focus of this video. And guess what? I'm moving! I can't believe it. I have 2 months to sort out 20 years of shit in my house and move it 3 hours away. It's fucking awesome. And then HearseCon is coming, like, right when I'm supposed to be moving in where I'm moving to. Yeah. So I'm a little stressed. Oh yeah, my hearse doesn't, well, it runs, but it doesn't pass emissions. So, I have that problem. I swear to the gods, every year, every fucking hearse con is like this, where like 2 days before we get the hearse running and then I go on this freaking 16-hour car trip that hopefully it makes it. Okay. Anyway, so, we're going to talk about the horse. And I'm going to include photographs of this disease, so if you're squeamish, number one, I don't know why you're on my channel, and number two, you might want to click away and go watch something happy. As you know, I'm going to kind of recap what happened since the New Year. So, New Year's Eve, I got a call from the stable saying that there was blood on my horse, so I went out there and it was pretty serious, and I called the vet out and she determined that the horse had cellulitis. And what cellulitis is, when bacteria that's on the outside of the skin somehow gets introduced into the deeper layers of the tissue and it finds a nice anaerobic area and is all nice and cushy and warm, it starts to reproduce, causing pain and swelling. It's not a fun time. So, we thought that's what the horse had. At this point, we're still thinking. We don't, I guess, can't really say what the horse had exactly. But the cure for it, which was yay antibiotics and painkillers, worked. So, that was good, right? But through the course of her having this, she's got a bloody nose, and I kind of thought maybe it was from the gore on her chest, or, you know, maybe she, you know, got some of that in her nose, so she, you know, had cellulitis in her nose. Not really sure. So, the vet gave me, also another treatment was special shampoo that I put on her. So I was treating her twice a day with this special shampoo and everything, and so the vet says, just use the shampoo on her nose. Well, yeah, I should have not listened. The horse did not approve of having shampoo shoved up her nose, but neither here nor there, it didn't really work on her nose. And so when it was only in one nostril, and then when it spread to the other nostril, I called the vet back out and said, okay, I need help here. So we decided to give her an oral antibiotic for 10 days. And it seemed to be getting better. And then on day 9, guess what? She got a bloody nose. So I called the vet back. And the vet's like, okay, well, let's do another series of 10 days. So she was on oral antibiotics twice a day for 20 days. When that ended, it seemed to be fine and cleared up. And her nostril looked normal. So everything was great for 7 days. And then, guess what? Bloody nose. So I text the vet. I'm like, hey, got a bloody nose again. And she's like, okay, well, then it's got to be an underlying issue. And she says, can I share your pictures? Which we were texting back and forth, which, hey, any, you know, vets out there who might for some weird reason come across my channel, texting with your clients is a good way to go, especially in this day and age. But you probably need a second cell phone for work because I'll probably text you all the time. Anyway, I tried to use my gift very responsibly and not text her all the time. So, let's see, where were we? Antibiotics. underlying issue. Yes. So she talked to a specialist, and the specialist said, hey, it could be pemphigus. So the vet tells me, pemphigus. And I'm like, Pemphi-what-now? So, pemphigus. Yeah. I Googled it. Not good. So I'm going to impart to you the information that I have learned. Now, pemphigus is typically seen in dogs and humans, not so much cats and horses. There are two kinds, which is, forgive me, I will probably say it wrong, foliaceous and vulgaris. Now, the foliaceous is on your regular skin, just, you know, anywhere, your leg, your arm, whatever. And the vulgaris is typically seen in the mouth. So what pemphigus is an autoimmune disease that attacks the connective tissue between the cells. So it decides that that's an enemy. So some of the typical symptoms are going to be swelling, bumpy skin, maybe bloody spots, or, you know, like a little raised area that gets bloody, which, I mean, could look like a bug bite. It could look like, you know, any other, you know, skin symptoms. It could look like a cut or a raw spot, you know. There may be some secondary signs like bloody coronet bands, or, you know, kind of oozing in places maybe there shouldn't be oozing. Fever, depression, loss of appetite, lethargy, weight loss. The skin may be painful to the touch, and the swelling could make it difficult to walk or lie down. And, you know, that could be a myriad of other things. Even the cellulitis, I mean, has the same symptoms, you know. And so, like I said, it's really hard to diagnose this, and the only way to be sure if this is what you got is to do a needle punch biopsy. Say that fast. So, you know, it's not as cool as it sounds, because it sounds like it's a hole punch and you just come out and go chunk, and there's, you know, but no, it's like a coring sample. You have to, like, drill into the, you know, fortunately you don't need much skin, I guess. And apparently the people who examine this stuff like the scabs too, so yuck, kind of gross. So I had the vet come out and do the coring sample, and I'm happy to say she does not have cellulitis. It appears to be an allergy to something, probably flies, but I'm not totally sure. I'm still, you know, kind of working with the vet on this, but this is what I know so far. So I'm incredibly relieved that it's not cellulitis, because cellulitis is not good. In humans, before the advent of modern treatments, you know, which includes antibiotics and prednisone, the mortality rate for pemphigus was 90%. Now, with today's modern treatments, the mortality rate's more like 5 to 15%. In 1998, pemphigus vulgaris was the fourth most common cause of death due to skin disorder. Now, with horses, you're still going to be using the same thing. It's like a massive dose of antibiotics and horsey prednisone. Actually, they've found prednisone's a little better than some of the other steroids that they can give. Because unfortunately what happens when they do this, they give a huge dose and it can cause laminitis, also known as founder, which, you know, you may have to put your horse down just because of that. It's not a good thing. And the horse is never over pemphigus. It doesn't ever go away. It goes into remission, and like in a year you can have another flare up. And the more it flares up, the worse it gets, and usually horses that get pemphigus are put down. And with that, good night, America, wherever you are.